Okay, I'm going to present this study, and first of all I want to thank the people at ECMWF and my institute which helped me in the setting of the numerical experiments that I'm going to present. First of all, I like to start with this sketch, which was a bit one on the basis of the idea of doing predictions on a short-term climate timescale. The idea is basically that. If you have a climate variable and there is a forcing and there is a sort of trend and there is natural oscillations, and then if you are able, if you don't initialize basically, and you start for given a state that has nothing to do with the initial states, but you impose the correct forcing with a model, you are in principle able to follow the trend of the variables. On the other hand, if you initialize and you have a correct initialization, I suppose that you have a very good the slow part of the system is possible to be followed. Basically, you can follow for the beginning these oscillations. But if the forcing is not correct, of course, after a while you lose predictability. And if you put all together, so you put in the forcing and the correct initialization, you can hope to be able for the short term to follow the climate oscillation. So in principle, to predict if there are some pauses in the warming, or if there are accelerations in the warming for a while. So basically, the idea is just to fill this gap between seasonal forecast and climate projections. This exercise of the KEDAL prediction sort of started, also because shown that in perfect model context, this kind of exercise was useful. So basically, there was in some areas of the world there were a sort of extended predictability, and so then we arrived to this to the last IPCC R5 chapter 11 that was devoted to the initialized predictions and projections. And you can see here, everybody knows, of course, these figures, and you can see that actually the model world is very, very different than the real world, and the bias in the models are actually huge. In some cases, really incredible. And these are the direct model outputs for SSTs, And this is in black. There's observed behavior of SSTs. And once this is unbiased, you can find that there is a big spread. But more or less, the models are able to follow the observed trajectories. And so, basically, coming back to the sketch, the idea is that actually this is a very good sketch in a perfect world, or in a perfect model world. And in a way, one could say if things were like that, one could hope to estimate basically a sort of crossing time or crossover time when the importance of initial conditions higher than the importance of the forcing. But since we are not in a perfect world, because our models are sort of describing not exactly our planet or our climate. It's what happens is something that is quite here, weird. Despite of this, actually, when one look at the predictions that were done for and they were put with the multimodal prediction in this report, actually, one can see that comparing for the mean global temperature and comparing basically the initialized predictions versus the projections, there is sort of a marginal, well, there is a signal. So basically the initialized predictions are able to be more consistent with the pause of the hiatus in the global warming with respect to the projections. And for example, in the case of some specific indicator that like the AMV, the Atlantic multi-decadal variability, actually one can see that in this area the predictions are sort of doing a much better job than the projection. So despite of this bias, the model, there is some signal. Probably not as good as expected, but there is something. So the idea is it would be okay maybe if we are able to decrease the bias in the model, then the model could initialize, they could do a better job on that. So what I'm going to present now is these experiments that have been done with the ECNWF couple model, which is the same, basically the same as that has been described by Franco before, and in which in this case there is also the sea ice component initialized, and it is a more recent cycle with respect to the current seasonal system cycle. But basically, and the resolution, which is T255, so about 80 kilometers for the atmosphere, is the same. So I used these systems, and I basically repeated the exercise of the CMIP-5, but doing shortened integration, so only 3 year long integrations, every starting from November 88 to November 2009, so 22 starting dates every November and 5 ensemble members. So they are actually multi-year, not decadal integrations. And this is our control integration, and they should be compared with high resolution integration for the atmosphere. So basically the same, exactly the same system. But in this case, the resolution of the atmospheric component has been doubled. So basically it's T511, which is about 40 kilometers in horizontal. And so then now, first I'm going to show some results of this, and then I will talk a bit, if there is time, about these other experiments. So basically, the first thing is, what about the bias? And here I'm going to show the bias for the 2 meter temperature. Here we have the control integration, so basically the T255, so 80 kilometers in horizontal, and here you can see the high resolution integrations. And this is for the first season after the initialization, so it's DJF. This is the average, the mean over the first year of integration, and this is the average over over the 3 years. And basically, one can see that there is, especially at if one consider the last the whole period, a decrease in the bias, and especially in the tropical Pacific, which is quite consistent. But basically, so one could expect that this decrease in the budget could lead to somewhat better predictions. And so here you can see what happened in the first season. The first season is DJF, and then this is anomaly correlation for the air temperature and seasonal, and this is the control, and this is the air resolution. And one can see that actually the air resolution, there is an impact especially, but which is quite interesting over Africa, over this part of over Europe. Even if over Europe, actually the signal is not significant, but is moderately positive, while it's there is no signal and even a bit negative in the control. If one look at the multi-year integration, actually one can see that basically for the first year there are no detectable differences, but if one look at the two year. The average year two and year three, actually one can see an improvement over the Pacific and the same an improvement all over the region of the subpolar gyre. So one can expect in a way to see something also, an improvement also in the prediction of the hiatus. And here it's the prediction for the 2 to 3 years for the TAS in global, and this is the control. Here you can see that actually I forgot to mention before that the volcanoes were not included in the forcing. So basically here is like one can see that what happened is that the model missed completely this case, but which was quite expectable. And then for the control, we don't have a very good prediction for this period of the hiatus for the year 2 to 3. But actually, there is the high resolution is not much, is not incredibly better. It is not much better. There is some signal here, but if one put together all the ensemble members, basically they belong to the same distribution. Then, just quickly, I would like to show some results for basically. An experiment in which one look at the sensitivity of the initialization of the initial condition in these experiments. And the idea was just to repeat the experiments for 3 starting dates, just shuffling, switching and swapping the forcing and the initial condition. And this experiment was already done in a multi-model context for only 2 initial conditions. And basically, what it's interesting here is when you swap, for example, I chose randomly 3 starting dates, which are 88, 2002, and 94. And for example, if you do, we switch the forcing between 88 and 2002, even at the first year, you can see a signal. Basically, in blue is the control, and the red is the integration in which the forcing, in this case, is the forcing of 2002, and in this case, is the forcing of 88. And basically, there is, even in the first year, quite a change, which I didn't expect, because in other experiments we didn't see that. So basically, it seems that there is a very big sensitivity to the forcing in this case. And if one look at 94, even the same with 2002 is more or less the same. So big sensitivity and to the forcing. And this is not the same for example, switching different date, 88 and 94. For year one, if one look other year, it's more or less the same. So there is a very big sensitivity to the forcing. I can skip here because I show different basins, but I can skip to to the conclusion, which I lost. So basically, you can read the conclusion. I don't want to repeat the conclusion, but I wanted just briefly to say something that it was about the idea of a benchmark in which one could really try to understand the role of the initialization in predictions. And so far, all the times the initialized prediction were compared to non-initialized predictions. But this is a bit comparing orange with apples, because in one case, we are just operating over the attractor of the model. And in the other case, basically, we just pull the model outside the attractor, even for full initialization, but also with anomaly initialization. So I think that is very difficult to understand what is going on. And I thought that if really one wants to be pragmatic about trying to do predictions, the best way would be actually to compare predictions with the best possible initial conditions and the forcing with predictions with initial conditions that are taken from the real world, not from a model, and see how is the sensitivity. Because I would say that this is very important to understand if this exercise is really important. It's really well if you can go on with the predictions. What are the potentiality of the methodology? Okay, thank you very much.